Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the City of Muskegon City Commission meeting for January 24th, 2017. Before we begin the proceedings, I'd like to invite up Pastor Tim Cross from Living Word Church to lead us in prayer, and that'll be followed by the Pledge of Allegiance. Pastor?
Would you bow your heads with me, please? Father, we just come before you, and your word says we're to offer prayers and thanksgivings and intercessions on behalf of all people, but especially for those that are in authority, that we might lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. So, Father, I pray for this commission, and I thank you, first of all, for each of them. I thank you for their service. I thank you for their sacrifice and their willingness to help and serve our community. So, Father, we say thank you for them. And we say thank you as well for the other people that work here in the city, and our police officers, our firefighters, those that work in the various departments that serve us. We say thank you for them. And Father, we would ask that you would bless them and that you would protect them and that you would grant them wisdom. Father, you said if we lack wisdom, we can look to you, and you're a generous, loving, giving God, that if we would ask you, you don't rebuke us for asking, but you freely give us. So we look to you for wisdom in the decisions that come before them. We pray for the peace and the prosperity of our city and this community, O God. That, Father, that peace would reign in our streets, and as Jesus taught us to pray, that the influence of your kingdom, that righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit would come to our city, and that, Father God, that you would prosper our businesses, you would prosper the people of our city, and that, Father God, this would be a city of joy and a city of peace. And so, Father, we thank you for your help, and we look to you for help, and we thank you for helping our city. In Jesus' name, amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Pastor. May we have the roll call, please?
Commissioner Turnquist?
Here.
Commissioner Johnson?
Here.
Mayor Galran?
Here.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Here.
Commissioner Warren?
Here.
Commissioner German?
Here.
Commissioner Mitsubishi-Biga?
Here.
Thank you. Before we get into the meat of the business, I believe we have a presentation by Mike Overly from MERS this evening. Good evening, Mr. Smith.
Good evening. Just real briefly, as many, if not all of you know, that the city's been going through a lot of changes and looking at a lot of options in regards to looking at reducing city's overall cost as it relates to pensions. And this evening we have with us Mike Overly, who is the regional manager from MERS of Michigan, to give us a presentation of what some of the changes are going to look like with regards to the plan that's before you this evening.
Okay, thank you. Good evening, Mr. Overly.
Oh, good evening. Thank you for having me. I appreciate the opportunity. Thank you for not having snow for me. I appreciate that as well. So maybe not too much longer. Does everyone have a copy of this?
Yes,
I apologize,
sir,
that this didn't make it into your packets prior to the meeting.
We're missing one.
Tried to condense everything down here for you so that it was hopefully in a good, easy to read and understandable format. If everybody has that, I'll dive right in. Again, my name is Mike, regional manager. As Derek said, I've been with MERS for about 12 years and cover really the west portion of the state, so from about Oceana County down to Hillsdale, so working with about 200 municipalities. So, but to jump right into the packet here, I know you're all familiar with MERS. I just wanted to provide the commissioners with a reminder, if you will, that MERS is an independent nonprofit retirement services company, and we are governed by an elected board of 9 members. And as you'll note there on the bottom of page 2, a variety of different products and programs that MERS offers, that wheel, if you will, has continued to evolve and change as the needs of Michigan municipalities have grown and evolved and changed over time. So that's the end of the commercial, I promise. So to get into really the meat of this conversation, what are we talking about here? As Derek explained, we're talking about a proposed, what we call bridge to the benefit multiplier of the defined benefit pension plan. So to go up to a high level here real quick, and I've got some information on page three. The city offers today two different retirement plans. A defined benefit plan, which is sometimes referred to as a pension, it provides a lifetime benefit. That plan is closed for the city. So that means that new employees of the city, regardless of their classification, they do not enroll in that plan. The employees who are in that plan as of the date that closed remain in that plan. The new plan, as of about 10 years ago, is a defined contribution plan, which is a 401k type plan. So this is dealing with the traditional pension plan, and the traditional pension plan determines the benefit that an individual employee will get based on the information that you see there on the top of page three. It's that red, the red boxes, and it's a three-part formula, if you will, that each individual can plug in their numbers and they can determine, hey, what is the lifetime of benefit that I'm going to get? And so the three pieces quickly here are what we call final average compensation, service credit, and a benefit multiplier. So final average compensation quickly is just the amount of wage or salary that we're going to use to base the individual's pension upon. So what's the average salary over a period of time? And that's the number we're going to say, okay, we're going to base your pension on that average wage. So that's final average compensation. Service credit is if you work full-time basically for the city, every single month you're going to get service credit. And then the more months that you have, you get more years of service. Over time, you have many, many months and years of service. The longer service that you have for the city, the better your pension benefit becomes. So that's part two. And then part three is the benefit multiplier. And currently for the DPW division that we're talking about here tonight, as of this moment, that benefit multiplier is a 2.25% multiplier. What that basically means in more straightforward terms is that for every year that an employee works in the defined benefit plan, in the DPW department at the city of Muskegon, he or she is gonna earn 2.25% of whatever their average salary is. So to make it simple, I didn't give you a calculation here, but somebody that works 10 years times 2.25% per year, they're gonna get 22.5% of whatever their average salary is. And that's the amount that he or she is going to earn in their retirement on an annual basis for the rest of his or her life. So that's the defined benefit, you know, how the plan works, you know, in a nutshell for the DPW plan. And again, we're talking about the closed plan. So with any defined benefit pension plan, I like to think of it as it's a lifetime promise, but I like to think of the plan in terms of a scale. So if you think about a lifetime promise, that represents a liability for the city. So think about liabilities on one side of the scale, and what is used to pay those liabilities then is assets. So think about assets or dollars on the other side of the scale, and we really ultimately need those scales to be even so that the liability and the promise can be met by an equivalent level of dollars. Now what happens sometimes in defined benefit plans is the scales become, they get out of balance. The liabilities exceed the assets, and the plan is sometimes referred to as what we call underfunded. So there's underfunded means that there's time that people have earned, but it's not yet paid for. And the lower the funded level of the plan, the higher the contribution amount that is required to bring that plan back up to 100%. So if you move with me to page four, I just wanted to give you again a sort of a snapshot, a short-term history for what does that funding history look like for the DPW division specifically. That information is shown at the in the box on the top of page four. So we said just sort of a 10-year snapshot there that we can see the funded percentage decline. There's a variety of reasons for that. But we're currently, as of the end of 2015, which is the most recent data that MERS has for all municipalities that participate in our system, the funded level of this particular division was 88%. Another way of looking at that is saying that for every dollar that's promised to a retiree or a future retiree, as of that particular moment in time, December 31st, 2015, there was 88 cents on hand to pay for that. So that's not a bad thing that it's underfunded. Not everybody's drawing right this minute. We've got active employees, we've got retired employees. But ultimately, MERS, as the fiduciary of the system in partnership with the city, has to ensure that that plan gets to a full funded position. So that's the first page, first part. And then the second table there at the bottom of page four shows you the corresponding contribution rates. And so these are broken into two separate categories. You see the employee contribution in the far right-hand side, and then where it says computed employer contribution, that's a dollar amount that you see there. That's the dollar requirement from the city of Muskegon. And each year, the city makes a payment to this plan to pay for the existing employees, as well as to make up for any funding gap. So we're at 88%. Ultimately, we got to get to 100%. So this contribution incorporates the need to move that funding level from where it is today to a 100% funded level. So any questions on that? I just wanted to give you a little flavor for the numbers for this particular division. So what we're specifically looking at, didn't miss anybody, did I? Okay, just making sure, sorry. Okay, so on page five, so what we're looking at here is what's called a bridge, or a change or lowering of the benefit multiplier. We just talked about that three-part formula that's used to calculate an individual's pension benefit. So what we're looking at here is lowering the pension multiplier on a moving forward basis. So I mentioned earlier, right now, today, the multiplier is a 2.25% multiplier. What is being proposed is changing it for all future service to a 2% multiplier. So it's a decrease. It's not changing the fact that the individual is still in defined benefit. They still are. They still have a lifetime promise. It's still calculated in the same fashion that we saw. It's just that now individuals will have a two-part calculation when that individual goes to retirement. They're going to have, from the day they started to the day that this proposed is effective, February 1, 2017, they're going to have all of that time earned at a 2.25% multiplier. Then on a moving forward basis, the remainder of their time at the city, or more specifically in this division, will be earned at the 2% multiplier. So still defined benefit, but just a two-part calculation. I won't go through the rest of the details there, but just a little bit more details as far as how that works. I think the key things that you're probably going to be most interested in is what's the bottom line impact for the city in this regard, not only today, but in terms of a long-term cost savings approach. So moving over to page six, whenever a community is taking a look at making an action like this, we engage our actuaries, and the purpose of our actuaries getting involved is just to say we want to be as upfront as we possibly can in showing you, you know, what is the impact of making this decision both today and in the future. So if you've got my copies here, I highlighted the key figures. What we're looking at here is a full-fledged actuarial report. I will not bore everyone by going through this line by line. But if you look, starting at the top, or actually on the left, you'll see the left-hand sort of column lists a lot of different categories, and then you'll see a column that says current benefits. You'll see one that says proposed benefits, and then you'll see the difference. So current benefits is the calculation as the plan exists today. Proposed benefits is what if we do this bridge effective February 1st to the 2% multiplier, and then column four there, difference literally takes the difference. So bottom line, in terms of the funding level for this particular division, if this change is adopted and implemented, the funding level would increase slightly less than 7%, 6.9%. And maybe in more real terms, what is the impact on the contribution requirement for the city? Currently it's at 285,000 plus. It would change to 122 for a savings of $163,000 plus dollars. So you see a significant contribution savings from taking that action. Again, that's right now. That's taking that action right now. So to follow up to that, on page seven, I didn't want to give you a 30-year chart or a 20-year chart. I felt like that might have been a little bit much to look at, but page seven, I wanted to just sort of illustrate for you graphically what does this change look like from a longer-term perspective. So on page seven, again, you'll notice that there's two graphs. The graph on the left-hand side shows the funded percentage of this particular division, Division 12. So, you know, there's not lines here. You can't really look easily year by year. But the key thing to focus is we see a funding level decline, but then we see it come up, and then we see it come back up to 100%. Correspondingly, the graph on the right shows the projected contribution for the city, the annual amount that we project would be required by MERS for the city to fully fund this benefit for the employees in the DPW department. So the solid blue line, the higher of the two, represents the expected contribution pattern as the plan exists it is today. If the bridge isn't put in place and adopted February 1st, that's represented by the dashed green line. So you notice a significant savings there. Ultimately, one way or another, whether this action has taken place or not, the plan will move towards a fully funded position just by the policies and procedures that, that MERS has in place. But this really bends the cost curve, which I would argue for, you know, for the city and many other communities is sometimes necessary, frankly, just to meet your budgetary needs. To give you a feel just for perspective, in 2016, there were 45 communities across the state of Michigan that took a similar action of a bridge. Now, what that bridge looked like and how far they lowered the multiplier varied based on the needs of every community. But just to give you a feel, it's not an unprecedented action that can be taken. So I think that's I just wanted to give you a perspective. And in the MERS system, there's 840 municipalities. So just to give you a feel for where this fits in the whole piece. So that was really the key pieces. The last point that I just want to mention for the commission's notice is on the bottom of page 7, there's a very small graph. I apologize for the size. But we're looking at long-term costs here, and you'll note under the baseline column, just go right to the bottom line, it says long-term employer cost. You see the baseline level, that's what we expect it to be at long-term if the plan is left unchanged. And then under what we call option one, that's this bridge, you'll note that the number is lower there. And again, that's what we expect the long-term cost of this plan, should the bridge be implemented, to be if we do this effective February 1st of this particular year. I want to be respectful of your time. I could probably talk about this for an hour. I'm sort of a nerd on this kind of thing. So any questions that I can answer at all in this regard?
Any questions for Mr. Overly, commissioners? Commissioner Warren?
I think you had mentioned at the beginning about working with 200 municipalities in Michigan.
Yes.
Is that correct? So I know others are going through the process of the whole system, but this 2% rate, how does that rank in the state of Michigan? Is that pretty average, or how would you?
That's a great question, Commissioner. So I'll clarify one statement. So for just myself personally, I work with about 220 municipalities on the west side of the state. MERS as a whole has about 800, you know, obviously all over the state, upper and lower peninsula combined. The most common multiplier in the MERS system is the 2.5% multiplier, though, so you'll find a lot of that out there. Many communities have closed their defined benefit plans, so not unlike what the city did here a number of years ago, but they still have employees who are in it. That's followed closely by the 2.25% multiplier, which is what the DPW employees have, and then third place is the 2% multiplier. So I've seen a lot of plan changes, and there's really not a perfect, a one size fits all for any community. I think that's what's, you know, sort of cool about Michigan, that, you know, you get to decide what works best for the employees of today and tomorrow, you know, here at the city. So it's hard to give one exact fit, but I am seeing a lot more lowering of plans, or if defined benefit plans are being implemented, it's at a lower level than they used to be in the past. Historically were here, if it's the philosophy of a community to offer defined benefit, it's maybe at a little bit lower level for a variety of different factors: budget, politics, philosophy towards retirement, risk tolerance, things like that. Does that help a little?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
Ask a follow-up question. Of the communities that you work with in West Michigan, are there any communities that have a lower multiplier factor than this 2%?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
Do you know? Oh, okay. Yes.
That's fine. That's fine. Yes. That's just my question.
Commissioner Johnson, did you have something?
Go ahead. Real quick to piggyback on that. Is 2.5% the cap?
No.
On that? Okay.
It's a standard offering. It's the maximum standard MERS offering, and MERS offers a whole buffet of offerings. And but just a whole range of options.
Okay.
There are what we call non-standard offerings, benefit multipliers, and those can exceed 2.5. So you will find those going up even into the threes in some cases.
Okay. I noticed on here on page 6, if you could just clarify, for the member contribution rate, it says 5% under current benefits, 5% under proposed benefits, and then the difference being 12%?
Yeah. Yeah, that's the typo, and I didn't get that out of there.
Okay, so
it's not,
there is no difference, or there is a difference?
No difference. As proposed, and that would actually be a part of the collective bargaining process and city council, but no, that should say zero.
Zero, okay.
Thank you, actually, for mentioning that. I did not mention that. I appreciate you catching that.
Thank you.
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yeah, I was going to ask the same question, Commissioner, about the cap. But you did say that the actual, that for new employees, they can't enroll in that old pension plan. Is that what you stated?
Yeah, so this plan is considered closed.
Right.
So when the plan closed, the employees that were here at the time that the plan was closed, they remained in that plan, continued their working career for the city of Muskegon. New employees then enroll in a 401k type plan, defined contribution type plan. So they wouldn't have access to this.
So they'd be like kind of grandfathered in, they'll still get that 2.5 multiplier, is that what you're saying?
No, so this change, that's a great question, Commissioner. So this proposed plan change will affect everybody who is in the DPW division at the city, the remaining employees who still have this defined benefit. So the ones who were grandfathered in that have the lifetime pension, that's the individuals that this proposed change would affect.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Yes.
And would it just affect people who are still working, or would it affect people who are retired already?
Yeah, great question. This will affect just the individuals who are still working.
It just has to do with their years of service going forward from February 1st.
Correct. If that's the date of adoption, correct. Yes. Yeah, retirees, once you've left, you've locked in your benefit.
Anything else, commissioners? Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Okay, safe travels.
Thank you.
May we have the consent agenda, please?
Approval of minutes, City Clerk, summary request to approve minutes of the January 9th, 2017 work session meeting and the January 10th, 2017 regular City Commission meeting. Staff recommendation, approval of the minutes. Food truck registration fees, City Clerk, summary request. This is a request to adjust the mobile food vending fee to $50 for those food truck vendors who will participate in Taste of Muskegon. Taste of Muskegon has contacted staff with a suggestion and would make it a requirement that their participants register. Currently, food vendors participating in a special event are not required to register. This registration would be good through April 30th of the following year. Currently, mobile food vendors outside the city limits are required to pay $300 annually. Those having restaurants in the city of Muskegon have a fee of $150, and those with a brick and mortar business in the downtown development district pay $50 annually. Staff recommendation, approval. MADC grant for Kitchen 242. Assistant Finance Director and City Clerk, summary request. To approve the grant agreement with Michigan Economic Development Corporation for $200,000 for Kitchen 242. This grant allows for important upgrades at the kitchen, including ventilation improvements, technology upgrades, including demonstration mirrors, security cages, and locks for kitchen users to store their products, and many new and additional appliances. Also included in this grant is money for marketing and tables and chairs for events at the kitchen and market. Staff recommendation, approve the grant agreement with MEDC for Kitchen 242 and authorize staff to sign the grant agreement. Western Market lease agreement, City Clerk, summary request. The city has created chalets to be placed on Western Avenue to create affordable retail outlets. Staff will evaluate applications on a first-come, first-served basis. The intent will be to offer a variety of retail products. The agreement will be from May 1st through October 30th. Chalets will be required to be open on most days from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. Fees shall be for the entire season and shall be set as follows. 90 square feet, $1,125. 120 square feet, $1,500. 150 square feet, $1,875. A prorated rate may be offered for agreements beginning after May 1st. Staff recommendation, to authorize staff to sign the agreements with the future tenants. Everstream GLC Holdings Company LLC Metro Act Permit Engineering. Summary request. Approve the request for a permit from Everstream GLC Holding Company LLC and authorize the mayor to sign the permit. Staff recommendation. Approve the permit and sign the documents. Professional Services Agreement. Safe Built Public Safety. Summary request. The Director of Public Safety requests that the Commission review and authorize this professional services agreement between the City of Muskegon and Safe Built LLC. SafeBuilt has performed satisfactorily since the fall of 2012. Said contract expired in December of 2016. The new service contract has expanded SafeBuilt's responsibilities to include, but not be limited to, dangerous abandoned buildings. The contract reflects adjusted shared percentages and other financial adjustments to effectively perform and enhance the quality of service Safebuilt is to provide the city of Muskegon. The proposed agreement is to commence this month, January 2017, and concludes on December 31st, 2024. Staff recommendation: staff recommends approval of proposed new professional services agreement between the city of Muskegon and Safebuilt of Troy, Michigan. SEIU collective bargaining agreement. City manager: summary of request. City staff and service employees, international union representatives have worked over the past 4 months to develop a new five-year contract for the city's Department of Public Works personnel. As part of the agreement, a number of issues were addressed, including pension costs, wages, and benefits. The new agreement is beneficial to both parties. Staff recommendation to approve the collective bargaining agreement with the Service Employees International Union as presented. POLC, collective bargaining agreement. City manager, summary request. City staff and police officers, labor council representatives have worked over the past 9 months to develop a new five-year contract for the city's patrol officers. As part of the agreement, a number of issues were addressed, including pension costs, wages, and benefits. The new agreement is beneficial to both parties and is expected to help with police officer recruiting and retention. Staff recommendation to approve the collective bargaining agreement with the police officers labor council as presented. Defined benefit plan adoption agreement, division 12, DPW finance. Summary request to approve the defined benefit plan adoption agreement to bridge the pension benefit for current DPW employees from a 2.25% multiplier to a 2.0% multiplier with a frozen final average compensation. Staff recommendation to approve the defined benefit plan adoption agreement and authorize the mayor to sign the agreement. Correction to 2017 fee schedule department comments. Finance, summary request to approve the changes to the 2017 master fee schedule to correct or clarify department comments related to the rental department. Staff recommendation to approve the department comments changes for the rental department for the 2017 master fee schedule.
Commissioners, you've heard the consent agenda as presented. Are there any items you wish to have removed for further discussion? Commissioner Turnquist?
Item D and H.
That was D?
D is in David, H is in Harold.
H?
H is in.
Okay. D. Commissioner German?
Item F is in Frank, G is in German, and J as in jar.
Item B is in ball.
Any others?
If there are no others, I'd move to approve the consent agenda as read, minus items B, D, F, G, H, and J.
Support. Has been moved by Commissioner Johnson, supported by Commissioner Renzema-Saving, to approve the consent agenda as presented, minus items B, D, F, G, H, and J. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Renzema-Sipiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes. Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item B, Commissioner Warren.
I move we approve the request to adjust the mobile food vending fee.
Support. Okay. Been moved by Commissioner Warren, seconded by Commissioner Renzema-Sipiga to adjust the food truck registration fees. Commissioner Warren.
I just have questions for staff regarding this. Okay, I thought so. Okay. As far as this $50 application, would that then make it so that these food vendors could set up their truck in other locations in the city?
That's correct. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Do we have rules and regulations of where they can do that, at what times, all that?
We do have an ordinance in place right now that says where they're actually allowed. But I believe that the intent is to encourage them, since they already have their license, that they could participate in maybe the smaller venues that they wouldn't necessarily come and get a license for.
Okay.
Yes.
So actual, like festivals,
yeah,
things
exactly,
like that.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay. Do we need further applications every time they want to do additional events? Or once they have this, they could just show up?
Once they have that, they can just show up. Depending on where they're parking at and how long it is, we ask that they call our office, because we actually make note of that, and then we let the police department know so that they know that they're a licensed food vendor. Otherwise, they might get stopped and asked and have to see their license.
Okay. So is this something that we could see potentially more food vendors down at Pier Marquette or in places like that?
Pier Marquette would not be, because that goes under a different policy. That goes under the Engineering's and Department of Public Works, and they have a separate contract. So when it comes to the parks and that, it wouldn't really benefit that area. They would have to go through there.
Are there other parks that they wouldn't be able to set up in?
All of the parks currently go under the Engineering Department under Muhammad.
Okay. I guess what I'm kind of trying to get at, I think it's great that we're encouraging more food trucks. I'm very excited about that. I'm more trying to get to, would it be possible where we're showing up at McGrath Park and there's a food truck vendor there? Is that a possibility, or that?
No. Muhammad.
Good evening, Mr. Alchatel.
Good evening to all. Not without a contract that we usually bring before you.
So this is pretty much to encourage them at other events.
I believe this, the difference between them, I think this is within the public right-of-way itself and does exclude the parks.
Okay. Thank you.
Vice Mayor?
Question. At special events, say like at the Taste of Muskegon and those type of events, is that not, and a food cart wants to show up, doesn't they have to get, well, don't they have to get some other kind of special permission through whoever is sponsoring that event?
When there is a special event, they actually have to go through that event, so they don't have to go through our offices at all. It was actually Taste of Muskegon who came to us and requested this, because they see a benefit in the future that we could have more potential, more food trucks in the downtown area, because they're already licensed. So maybe on off days or on a Friday evening when there, say, is a party in the park and they want to be 1,000 feet away, that they could have, you know, on the pathway to party in the park, that they could have one parked out there.
Okay, because I just knew that in the past it was a certain amount of vendors that could be in there, I thought, and
yeah, going right through the special event, certainly, like they would contact them and they would register with them, and their fees are completely different. But this is something new that Taste of Muskegon wanted to try.
That's good.
Yes.
Thank you.
Good. Mr. Johnson?
I would just say I think this is a good improvement. We added this ordinance my first year on the commission. I think we've tweaked it every year since then to induce more people to take advantage of it, and I think this is another inducement, particularly those that are participating in Taste Muskegon. Now we'll have that permit for the year to set up throughout. I mean, basically, it's throughout our downtown, our DDA, plus Laketon, Apple, Port City, Industry Park.
The industrial parks.
Okay.
Right.
So hopefully they'll take advantage of that, especially downtown. Oh my goodness.
Right.
You could make a killing on the weekends in the summertime downtown if you had a food truck set up down there. So hopefully those that do participate, we'll see more of them in the coming years. So I think this is an improvement. So we're supporting it.
That could be our second career together, Kevin.
Let's do it.
Roll call, please.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rensselaer-Sibiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galran?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item D, I believe it's Commissioner Turnquist.
In regard to the Western Market lease agreement, I move that we authorize staff to sign the agreements with future tenants.
Support. Second. It's been moved by Commissioner Turnquist, seconded by the Vice Mayor, to authorize staff to sign the agreement with future tenants, referencing the Western Market lease agreement. Commissioner Turnquist.
My question is the length of the season, May 1st through October 31st, which adds basically 60 days to the total proration, when seasonally early part of May is not good in my mind, October is gone. But if you have more days like that, the city will receive less income on your proration. I think we should shorten that season to, if you want to be optimistic, May 15th to September, whatever, 30th. So we get more of the rental fees that you're recommending.
The proration was meant for people who possibly sign up after May 1st, who don't actually register and schedule for a chalet till after May 1st, that we would do a proration rate. But everybody's expected to be there through October 30th. Now, that doesn't mean, because this is our first year, that we're going to have some, you know, we're going to learn as we go. So if we find that it's, you know, slower than beneficial to everyone there, that maybe we look at that season and shorten it. But right now, that's our intent, is to go through October 30th. But the only reason for the prorated amount was if somebody suddenly came along, say we had an open one that we weren't able to fill, and they came around June 2nd, we wouldn't want to charge them all of May that full rate. So we would prorate it.
But anyone can come along and say, I don't want to start. I don't know how many units we're talking about. The optimist would say they're all going to be gone by May 1st. I don't see that happening with the marketing time that we have.
We have eight right now who have inquired, who are waiting for an email tomorrow from me. The interest has been really well, and we haven't actually even marketed for it yet. So I'm actually feeling pretty optimistic about it. I can't promise anything, but at least the interest is really out there, because the rent, the lease payment is really good. It's a good amount to be downtown. So I have a lot of enthusiasm going on right now, but we'll see once it's time to sign the agreements as to what happens. But certainly I'm going to try with everything I have to have them filled by May 1st.
Okay. Mr. Manager?
Yeah, June, I just wanted to piggyback on that. I think we thought they were, you know, the peak summer season was a slam dunk. And we wanted to really start seeing our summer season expand and to be more of a year-round situation. So that's why we kind of added a little bit of time at the beginning of the year and a little bit of time at the end of the year, because we don't think that what the current season is has to be what it, you know, is long-term. We're trying to build this season, hopefully that eventually supports retail and brick and mortars, you know, all year long. So we're trying to, like I said, I think we think the activity downtown, probably June, July, August, is going to be amazing, and we're trying to create activity September, October, April, and May, or May, I guess, for now. But hopefully at the end of the day, have it all year long. I think we saw that with, like, even the simple addition of First Fridays that went through into the fall. We saw some pretty popular events on Friday nights down there that we hadn't really even considered doing. They were pretty easy to put together, and they attracted a lot of people. And so we're hoping the consistency of this into the fall will help build that into the future.
Very good. Commissioner Warren?
How many units are there again?
There's going to be either 9 or 10 at the moment, yes.
I will say I have had a lot of questions about this. Mm-hmm. People reaching out to me, residents, I found out more information, right. So that is exciting.
Yes.
Has it been considered to have an application deadline rather than just on the first come, first serve, so we can ensure more diversity? If we were to get, you know, 20 applications rather than the first 10 being who got the slots.
And we could do it that way. Sure.
And maybe only 6 will be handed in, and it will be first come, first serve. But that way we can maybe try and ensure that diversity, not only among the business owners, but the products.
And so far the interest that I've had has been all over the board, which has been great. It's mm-hmm. Nothing has been duplicated, as I say, where anybody's competing with each other. They're, you know, it's either photographs or it's glass work, or it's all different. Mm-hmm. So far it's been pretty exciting what we've seen.
Good.
If I could say too, I think we've been, as at the staff level, because the interest was so great from the tenant side and really from the fundraising side, our thought was if there are legitimately 20 groups that want to be in there, we would do our best to find a way to raise money and get 20 sheds, because mm-hmm. 20, at the end of the day, 20 occupied.
Chalet is not sheds.
I got a couple for calling
don't
sheds.
Don't do that.
Market, chalets.
Watch your
20 will still be better anyway than 9 or 10. Mm-hmm. And so I think we were looking at it as saying, okay, let's see how these 10 go. And if there really is that much interest, mm-hmm. let's try to find a way to build as many of them as we can reasonably occupied.
If we can kick out, that's all right, yeah.
It'll make that much stronger of a market, hopefully.
If there's 15, we want to do 15.
Do we have any idea on the construction cost of the 10 units?
Well, we're aiming at 9 for about $20,000, which is what we've raised. We tasked our project coordinator to,
No, I was just going to say I did get a price on the first one.
Okay.
Oh.
Well, I haven't heard it yet, so I probably don't want to hear it from all these people, but.
I did just ask.
We essentially asked Tim Harvey to build us one at the level that he thought was, you know, at quality level where he wanted to be, and then let's see what that broke out to per square foot and decide if we had to step back the quality or if we had more room to add more quality, but you can tell us what we have on the first one.
I'm sorry, I said a taxi answering me, but the first one is actually completed and behind the farmer's market. It's not, the finished part is not, but you can actually go behind the farmer's market and see it, and we've gotten so many inquiries just from that. And by adding the window and the door in there, it's at $2,000, but the finishing work is going to probably bring it up between $3,000 and $3,500 is what he believes. So that's probably what we're going to be looking at on average.
So we might have a little work to do in terms of cost. Right.
So it'll take us a couple
of years.
At the
end of the season, what's going to happen to the units? Can we store them, or are they going to be disassembled?
There's no disassembling.
I don't think there's much disassembling them. We'll probably be stored either someplace or stored on site.
And we were talking about having a maybe between Thanksgiving and Christmas of having a holiday. I have an opportunity for another group of people maybe coming in and doing a holiday for like 6 weeks down there in the winter on the weekends.
Commissioner?
Have we gotten any comments from brick and mortar people about this? It is a little bit of a, like the Century Club has smaller spaces to rent and these are a lot less overhead. There's no code requirements and things like that.
We built them to code, didn't we?
Yeah.
Yes. We haven't had any major negative comments. I think the telltale sign will be if the bid board, which is made up of mostly brick and mortar people, they were meeting while we were meeting to decide if they were gonna donate money to it. My guess is if we see them donating money to it representing brick and mortars, we might know, well, you know, that there is that much there. But we've pitched it to them essentially as, if you want more brick and mortar, we're going to have to incubate a retail market downtown because there's just, it's not there yet. I think it'd be different if there was a lot of brick and mortar space that was unoccupied right now, but we're not seeing that. I don't know that even the Century Club has a lot of extra space to add, you know, to add these people into it if they even wanted to.
Anything else, commissioners? Commissioner Warren?
Will there be like electricity and bathrooms and?
We will have electricity. You know, I'm aiming for the 220 for watts or amps. And for restrooms, we did talk about, there's a close one by at the farmer's market, and we did talk maybe about adding a port-a-john, might be a possibility too, putting one on site.
Yeah. I think the code requires have one within like 500 feet or something like that, and at the farmer's market met that requirement. But we're gonna kind of play it by ear and see how popular they are and see if we need to have one, you know, decoratively put on site somewhere if the need arises.
Do you have anything, Commissioner Johnson?
Oh, I was just going to piggyback on Frank's comments. I believe we did confer with the Chamber of Commerce on the pricing for what to rent these out for, and so presumably they're taking into consideration brick and mortar's interest as well. And it is a pretty good deal, for sure. But it's going to be meant to be as incubator, like the city manager indicated. And apparently there's actually one outfit in the Century Club that wants to have a supplemental shed outside. So I don't necessarily think it's a mutually exclusive situation. And the cost, while being more than the $20,000 we donated, it looks like that between what we're charging for the chalets, the revenue that will be coming for that, will offset the additional cost, so we're going to be getting roughly $15,000 to cover that extra $15,000 cost for it. So it'll be revenue neutral to the city while helping to foster some greater commercial and retail activity downtown. So I think this is a great initiative. Thank you, staff, for working on this and making this a possibility. So excited to see them launch.
If I could just add one thing too, the goal was, if you remember last year we did the volleyball court, it's this idea of activating these otherwise just kind of dead spaces in our downtown and put new life into them until we get permanent life.
And if I mean, I think it's a great location what we're having, because part of me was like, why are we not like utilizing the stalls that we already have there at the farmer's market? Let's rent those out and get some of these incubation there on some of these smaller vendors. But having it where it's positioned in that vacant lot helps connect the farmer's market with our downtown, especially on market days. People will be more likely to walk, you know, a couple blocks, check out those retail chalets, and then walk another block or two blocks down to the breweries or the restaurants. And so, yeah, it's helping to fill in that gap and activate all of Western Avenue. So, great work.
Yeah. And this fits the bill of a major recommendation that was made to us after my participation 2 years ago with the, which one was it?
Cincinnati group.
Yeah, the Cincinnati group. So the
University of Cincinnati.
The National Congress of Mayors. But it was like you have this beautiful downtown, but start using that vacant space, even temporarily, to heighten that excitement and get that those groups of individuals coming down and playing, you know, downtown. So it's, Commissioner Moore?
Talking about location, I know this concept we've talked about at Pier Marquette as well. Is that something that we are exploring for this upcoming season?
Not yet. We haven't explored. I think the permitting requirements are a little further out. Okay. Although we've had some pretty good conversations with the group that uses the restaurant down there, who has some interest in maybe doing something similar. So my goal was, if we have somebody interested in doing it, maybe we could kind of take a hands-off approach and provide the space and kind of let them take the business risk and, you know, and reward.
Do you know if that's something we would need approval from the MDEQ for sure? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else, commissioners? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Sipiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gallren?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Item F, I believe, Commissioner German?
Yes, I move item F, professional service agreement safe bill. Staff recommends approval of proposed new professional service agreement between the City of Muskegon and Safeville of Troy, Michigan.
Second.
It's been moved by Commissioner German, second by Commissioner Warren, to approve the proposed new professional services agreement between the City of Muskegon and Safeville of Troy, Michigan. Commissioner German.
Okay, this service agreement that we're looking at here proposed with Safeville will be for how long?
Good evening, Mayor and Commissioners. This professional agreement in front of you, I highlighted a few things that have changed in here that would be different than before. And Commissioner, you brought up a good point. This contract will go from 2017, now obviously, till December 31st of 2024. One thing that I want you to note in that. That is basically about an 8-year contract. Yeah, it's about a 7-year contract. But there's also a termination clause 8.3 in there that the city can terminate that agreement without cause or reason. And there's a section there that allows that.
Okay, but the agreement is signed. That's not in here, though, right?
Yes, it is in there. It's 8.3 that talks about the termination if something was to not go like it is right now.
Okay, and also my concern also, Safeville has been with city, contract with the city for how long?
Since 2012, about over 4 years.
Okay, and I'm actually speaking on behalf of some of the citizens who have had enormous complaints with Safeville. And, you know, and what they feel are some unfair practices also when it comes to businesses, opposed to our residents. And also some of the ordinances that they enforce, they feel that are being violated. So, you know, the more complaints we get, you know, we're not getting, I guess, quality service. That's what I'm looking at. So, have, you know, the commission have heard anything or I'm quite sure, I actually sent you an email last week, Frank, about a citizen who had a complaint, but this isn't the first time. So, you know, when it comes to service and we're going to contract with a company and they're not satisfying, you know, the residents, you know, there's a problem. And I've heard this, you know, repeatedly. So, I mean, I'd like to hear from Safeville, you know, Director Kurt, what is your take on this and how are you handling these complaints?
That's a good question, and thank you for that.
Kurt, you want
to take the podium, Kurt.
I'll follow up after.
Okay.
So we have a complaint process put in this new contract, and Jeff and I have worked through some complaint forms and a complaint procedure that if somebody has an issue. But Safeville's been pretty much involved in a lot of services and a lot of things in Muskegon. We offer two scholarships a year. We're involved in all kinds of things like Sister Cities and several other events. Every one of my team members is a Muskegon Star. They've been through that program. We're pretty involved with the community. You know, not everybody likes enforcement. That's our job. It's a very, sometimes, unpopular job. And I'm not doing this job to be liked. I'm doing this job to get my job done. And being a firefighter for 28 years, I've seen a lot of issues with homes that could have been prevented. Smoke alarms, wiring, heating problems. So I kind of know that field pretty well. I've been a building official for 24 years now. So yeah, you're not always popular when you do your job. If people have a complaint, they need to come to me first and I'll solve it for them. If they're not happy with that, there is a process that we're putting in place for a complaint form where they can go through Jeff and so forth.
Okay, one other question also. Have you had any complaints, even with staff, overstepping their boundaries when it comes to the rights of properties or property owners when they go out to do inspections for, specifically speaking toward the residents?
It's still a little bit unclear on that. It's property rights. You'd have to be a little bit more specific.
Well, I guess under some, okay, do you follow the ordinance and codes under state law down to city? Okay, so if state law states that you can't, just say for instance, go to a resident's property and look in their property in the window and take a photo of that property unless there's a warrant or some other reason, and you go ahead and do that, isn't that a violation of that code?
That would be if that was a law.
Okay.
What they have in section chapter 1 of the building code and chapter 1 of the residential code and also in chapter 10 of your city ordinance allows the inspectors access to property and homes. Normally we stay right in the front of the home. If we go to a house, we take the normal path to the front door, communicate with the people, or leave messages if we have to. We're allowed to take pictures. We're allowed to write letters for violations, and the tool of the pictures is we can send them a picture of what the violation is. So that's part of that tool.
Okay, so, and that property has to be owner-occupied in order for you to do that, correct?
No, rentals too, because we run the rental program. We do the registrations and the inspections. So if there's a complaint about a rental, we can respond to that, take exterior photos. The landlord usually lets us in for the interior complaints. We get complaints from neighbors, tenants, all kinds of people that need us to get into their properties. So you'll usually only go in if we're permitted to go in.
Okay. And just one other question. Now, the property down at the Watermark, okay, that I saw that built it on the corner of Division and Western, have Safe Built implemented all the necessary enforcements to that property?
So Watermark is a old factory you're talking about.
Exactly.
I forgot the name of the company that was there.
Mm-hmm.
Shaw Walker.
Yeah. Yeah.
We've enforced the environmental concerns with the grass and brush outside and any trash that was there. That's normally what we handle. Mm-hmm. Planning has been handling a lot of the broken windows and those sort of things.
So, and if they don't, because I was just by there, the other day, and there's still some things that needs to be done to that building. So I just want to make sure that the same enforcement and ordinance that you're enforcing on these residents applies to the business owners and these people that have, you know, millions of dollars, they're not, so they don't receive special privilege, or it's not a perception to the community as well.
Right, right. And we was concerned with Shaw Walker, as everybody is. Everybody's bought that property up lately. Mm-hmm. It is kind of a target for the city to get that cleaned up. But so is the Nelson 11 area. So is the whole Blight Fight area. So are the thoroughfares. There's a lot of area for us to cover. And we have one full-time code enforcement person that's out there chasing trash and grass. And we have a summertime lady that helps with that, too. So we have 1.5 people out there pursuing that. Plus, there's another one of our staff persons has taken one of the neighborhoods as a code enforcement person. So we've been enforcing the code pretty evenly throughout the city.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Warren, and then the Vice Mayor.
With your staff to enforcement ratio, we'll call it, you just said 1.5 when it's at its peak, right? Go ahead.
A little more, yeah, a little more than that.
So are those usually complaint-driven when it comes to the ordinance enforcement?
No, they patrol neighborhoods. They, okay. In the certain days, they're in certain neighborhoods. So
okay.
Tuesday, they may be in Nelson. Thursday, they may be in McLaughlin. They have a regular route that they follow. They're in that neighborhood every week, and they check the grass every week, and the rubbish complaints with tires, pallets, mattresses, whatever, they have a two-week follow-up. So the second week they're in that neighborhood, they're following up on that. It's an automatic system that runs okay. through BSNA.
Okay.
So they're throughout the entire city every week.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, Vice Mayor?
Yes, Kurt. I know that you guys have been working on it, and I have seen some improvement, I've heard of some improvement, and through my own experience. And I just want you to keep working on it, because just as you said, nobody likes code enforcement. Nobody likes enforcement of any kind. So when they do get that letter, they're a little upset already.
Yeah.
And just a little more friendly customer service
right.
over the phone and stuff,
yep.
you know, goes a long way.
Right.
And I just like to say, continue working on it.
Yeah, thanks. Well, I appreciate that, Eric. I happened to go through some photos for the planning department I had from 3 years ago and saw some of the enforcements that we're doing and the problems we had 3 years ago. I'd kind of forgotten how bad some parts of the city looked. And if you go by now, we don't have any near those serious violations anymore. So it's slowly getting cleaned up and looking better and better. So I'll take to heart your concern, though.
Okay, thank you.
Mayor, I can add just two things here real quick. Just when you get a chance, if you go to Section 5 on performance standards, there's three paragraphs here that specifically address how we're going to deal with complaints in the future. And we actually have been doing that in the past, but this is actually in writing now. And there are several weeks that we deal with complaints, and myself and you know, the chief building official here, Kurt, will bring the people in and we'll talk to them. And whether they're a business or a resident, a lot of times they have problems that are outside of their scope of, you know, ability to do stuff. We've given people weeks longer to take care of things. So there is discretion being used on our residents that just can't quite meet a timeline. We do the same thing with businesses. I want you to know, Commissioner, that we're not always by the book, so to speak, but they have to make their oral complaints, and you'll see that written here, this performance standard. That alerts me there's a problem. And then, like you said, if there's a issue of, let's say, entering a property or whatever, I can take that particular complaint, kind of dissect it, and then we follow the complaint and see what went on. And because we're trying to give all the citizens due process, but at the same time, like the other commissioner said, you know, they have to do their job and clean things up. And something we've done too, it's Grand Rapids had this model. We're doing the same thing now. We have an officer assigned just to Safebuilt. On the tougher ones, this officer gives them assistance on like a scheduled basis through the week to help them be more effective, but then bring that professionalism of an officer going there and trying to explain when they're doing the enforcement. And that's been helping a lot with the more difficult cases than Kurt and his staff kind of going out there alone. We send a police officer with them. I want the community to know that we're doing that. It's been very successful in Grand Rapids, and we're starting to see some success here, like they experienced. So.
Very good. Commissioner German?
Yeah, well, thank you, Chief. You said there's a clause also for reasons that we could discontinue the contract. And, you know, I know that, you know, your company is, your organization encourages staff pretty well. As a matter of fact, how many staff members do you have out there actually working for Safeville?
Yeah, I'm not off the top of my head, is it?
We have 10 now, and we'll have 11.
Yeah, we just hired one more, so there are 11 on staff. I think there's 17 people actually on that payroll, some on-call people like we have in the company.
Okay, okay. Yeah, and like I said, you know, I'm not out there, you know, in the field. You're out there. You guys are the expert. But, you know, speaking on behalf also of the residents and the citizens, you know, you have to address these things as elected official. And just like you have a job to do, I have a job to do as elected official to address these concerns. But I just want to make sure, you know, we're playing fair and, you know, by the, you know, by the rules. So that's my reasoning for, you know, addressing you today.
Yeah, that's a very good comment, Willie, and we take that to heart, too.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioners, I'll please have those citizens come in, make those oral complaints to us so we can write those down. So upon ask, like the police department last year, I had about 15 complaints for the year. People came and made a complaint. When you look at like 30,000 calls we got on, we had 15 complaints. It shows you the relationship between the calls we go on and the complaints. It kind of tells you something here where we're at. We'd like to do the same thing with Safeville. We know they do thousands of enforcement actions. So we'd like to know, how many complaints are there? Are there 10, 100, 1,000? We'd like to know also.
And just one other thing, you know, and just like you said, the relationship with, you know, the residents, you know, make sure that they're actually being treated like taxpayers should, and that's with the utmost respect.
Yeah.
You know, and I say this also, you know, when you first started, I had some work to do on a garage,
yeah.
And so I went through the same process, followed the same protocols, pulled the permit. So, I mean, I wasn't showing favor as a commissioner myself. And I, you know, complied, you know, with the rules and did what I needed to do. So I just wanted to make sure that, you know, we're all, you know, working together as a, you know, organization in the community as well. So.
Right, Willie. And last year we did just short of about 8,000 code violations, tall grass, rubbish, trash. And we did just a little over 1,000 building permits. Deb, might you know how many rental inspections we did? A lot. Okay, a lot. And so 8,000 code violations, you know, not everybody's going to be happy when you have to deal with 8,000 code violations. There's going to be a couple people, a handful, that are think they might have an issue. So we'll do our best to work with that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Commissioner Warren?
I just want to acknowledge this has been an ongoing process. I think it was a work session. We spent quite a long time working together on how to improve this contract, and say thank you for the effort and the staff that has helped inform us of what you see and how we can improve the process when it comes to customer complaints, and also that you are flexible. So any resident that gets a letter that either you disagree with or you have a hard time with the cost or anything, please reach out rather than just, you know, ignoring it or being mad or anything like that. That conversation, we've really seen you rise to the challenge of addressing the customer service issues. So I look forward to that continuing. And also thank you for the scholarships and the other investments you put in our community.
Yeah, thank you. Barbara, we're also, there is an appeal process that if somebody gets a code violation and they get an action from the crew to clean it up, there's an appeal process for that through us. If they're not happy with that process, it's an appeal process to the city, a separate board.
Mm-hmm.
So there's several ways that they can get justice if they feel they need it.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. Roll call, please.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Mensa-Masipica?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galvin?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Who is item G? I'm sorry.
Yes.
Item G, Commissioner German.
Okay, I moved for the SEIU collective bargaining agreement to take this item off the consent agenda for discussion purposes. And and to approve the collective bargaining agreement with the Service Employment International Union as presented.
Support. It's been moved by Commissioner German, seconded by Commissioner Rizmasavica to approve the collective bargaining agreement with the Service Employees International Union as presented. Commissioner German?
Okay, this item here was actually requested by city manager, so I'll just let him kind of expound on that.
All right, ahead. Sorry, man, I whispered in his ear. In the tentative agreement that was in your original packet, it showed number two as Appendix A and some changes to Appendix A. That should not have been in there. So what was set in front of you folks, right at the start of your meeting, and I know we went from one meeting right into the next, so I didn't get a chance to explain it to anybody, so that's why I wanted to pull it off. So the new document you have in front of you is essentially the same tentative agreement minus the changes to Appendix A.
Gotcha.
Any questions for the manager?
I had one other question on that. We changed the multiplier on this program, I believe, but to offset it to the employees, you increase the amount of increase in wages. So it's kind of is it a break even at this time, and eventually we will see some savings to the city?
Yep. I sent out, and I don't have it in front of me, but I sent out a kind of like a cost comparison versus what the new agreement will cost the city over the five-year term, and versus what the status quo will cost over the five-year term. And so if you look through there, it's more expensive than if we were to say leave everything the way it is and have no wage increases for 5 years. I don't think that's probably reasonable that we would end up with that. So when we compare it to leaving everything the way it is and having like a modest increase, so a 2 or 2.5% increase, you see over that 5 year period, there's between like $250,000 and $400,000 worth of savings over that 5 year period.
Eventually, level out.
Yep, the savings are more upfront in this particular one, and then they level out as the contract moves on. But if you know, the big note in here was the idea of the flexibility. The defined benefit is not the most flexible item to pay for. You know, there's a lot of ways that we can reduce costs, but it's really hard to reduce a cost for something that's already been accrued, and you can't go backwards on it. So the goal was to create the flexibility to be able to reduce costs if we ever need to in the future. So even though it's relatively revenue neutral, it gives us flexibility. That's very important going into the future.
Okay. Anything else for the manager? I'd just like to say thank you to the members of the SEIU and our staff who worked diligently on this. We'll set ourselves up for a much better place financially for all of us and the citizens of the city down the road, and we can continue to be noted as one of the more financially sound municipalities in the state of Michigan, as we have been over the past decade. Thank you very much. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Rizmasipiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turquest?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Motion passes.
And item H belonged to?
Me, I believe.
Okay, Commissioner Turnquist?
I would make a motion to approve the collective bargaining agreement with the Police Officers Labor Council as presented.
Support.
It's been moved by Commissioner Turnquist, seconded by Commissioner Johnson, to approve the collective bargaining agreement with the Police Officers Labor Council as presented. Commissioner Turnquist?
Yeah, my only question there is, as we've heard in the presentation, certainly the goal for the funding should be 100%. Or as close as we can get to it. This is 105% funding, which means we're setting monies aside. Why are we doing that?
I think if you kind of look at the graph for the SEIU one that was out there, you saw that it went up, but then it naturally went down a little bit before it worked its way back up. I think that saying it's 105% today, that's just a snapshot in time. So we know that there's opportunities for it to ebb and flow, for it to go down and then back up. The goal is to be 100% or more funded.
And why or more?
Well, like I said, because it could, changes in the market could cause it to go down tomorrow. It's just, you're looking at it as a snapshot in time today. So if you notice, before we made the change just yesterday, it was in the 90s. And even with the SEIU contract, They're proposing that it goes up, you know, up into the 90s, but if you follow it over the next couple of years, it naturally goes back down before it starts going back up. So this one will probably go back down a little bit before it goes back up.
Okay.
I mean, a small change, and if Derek or Mike want to talk about it a little bit, but a small change in returns, you know, investment returns could have a major impact on the funding level. And so we're not in a bad position to be a little bit overfunded, knowing that a lot of these programs were funded at 100% or more when we closed them. And you saw how quickly they degraded over the last few years, last 10 years. And we've done nothing but put our annual required contribution plus some in it year in and year out. We've still seen it degrade for one reason or another.
Is there any level at the funding that's enforceable? I mean, you hear about communities that are 50%. Are they apt to be fined or penalized or anything like that, or is there no enforcement?
Can I jump up here real quick?
Please.
Is that all right? Okay. That's a good question, Commissioner, and man, we could be here all night. But I can tell you, with some of the changes, there is a variety of reasons, as Frank mentioned, why a funding level can change from one year to another. And one of the key things to keep in mind with a defined benefit plan is you're promising a lifetime benefit. But as you can imagine, when you start to think about it, the wild card is, you know, we don't know how long folks are going to live. We don't know exactly what their pay is going to be when they go to retire, what's inflation going to be like, what our investment return is going to be like. So when our actuaries go to calculate the required contributions, they make a whole series of assumptions about that plan. So we say, these are the people that are in the plan, here's their benefit provisions, the multiplier vesting period, things like that. And then they say, for this group of people, let's make a whole series of assumptions about them based on past data, based on fact. And if the assumptions are accurate and they are based in reality, then the contributions should hold true. Now, that being said, with all due respect to anyone who knows an actuary, is an actuary, or plays an actuary on TV, assumptions are best estimates. They are never exactly right. They may be a little high, they may be a little low. So it's always a fluctuating number, as Frank said, based on that moment in time when you take a look at the plan, what is the funding level? Specifically to your question, Commissioner, there are communities in the MERS system, outside of the MERS system, across the United States that are at a whole variety of different funding levels. Some are very, very low, and some are well over 100%, and that's true in the MERS system as well. A policy that the MERS board has more recently adopted requires communities to move and ultimately attain a full funded position within a time frame, generally speaking, of no longer than 23 years. So there's a new focus on, if you have an unfunded liability, that represents time that has been earned already by the employees wherever they're at. But it is just not backed by money yet. So it's a liability, but there's no money to pay for it. So it ultimately has to get paid. And in the state of Michigan, there is constitutional protection for earned benefits, time that we've already earned in a defined benefit plan. So by the city being a part of the MERS system, the MERS elected officials have what we call the fiduciary responsibility of the system, meaning that employees are made a promise in defined benefit. We have to ensure in our partnership with the city and other municipalities that over time that commitment is fulfilled. So obviously if you're at a 50% funding level today, you've still got to get to 100 to fulfill that commitment that you've made to your employees and your current retirees. You know, the contribution requirements will be higher because you've got to go from 50 to 100 over a 2.5 roughly decade period of time. The higher you are funded, you still have a gap to close. It's just not as severe. So there are some communities out there, you know, where it is a more challenging financial situation, and just making the payments alone may not be sufficient to work within their budget. So then they look at other options, tweaks, changes that they can make within the scope of the law, in order to make those contributions more manageable. Does that help a little bit? So there's a lot of moving pieces and a number of different ways that you can approach the situation. But ultimately, I think as elected officials, and in some sense, it just gives me peace of mind as well. The policies that are now in place today, specifically in the MERS system, require that if an unfunded liability exists, regardless of the level of funding that you are at, you will get to a fully funded position. That's not going to happen today, tomorrow, 5 years, 10 years, generally speaking, but over a longer-term basis, you know, roughly speaking, a little more than 20 years, we're going to get to that level. So, and I would argue the plans are quite reasonably priced and sustainable, but the challenge with defined benefit pension plans, not unique just to Michigan, is the unfunded liabilities that exist for those plans. And you see that with evidence in Detroit, Chicago, and Illinois, and, you know, some of the ones that make the news constantly.
Yeah, I'd like to point out how, if not lucky, how blessed we are to have been proactive as we have been as an organization through the decades. We've been doing what we're supposed to do. We've been paying into our system. Our employees have been making their contributions. We've been doing everything right. Things change, and you might slip a few percentage points. But we're being proactive now so that we will continue to be the strong organization that we are going forward. And we will be 100% funded. There's 11 cities in the state of Michigan. A number of them, and I'm not bashing them, but a number of them are held up like, why don't you be more like these cities? Well, I'm glad I'm not, because even though in some ways they may seem to be at a different level of development than we are at this point, they are also on a list of municipalities of concern. If you can imagine that these 11 municipalities represent $1.2 billion in shortfall on what they should have banked for the retirement, it's pretty damn scary. And then what gets scarier is that you have movements out of Lansing to take a punitive stance against municipalities and other agencies, and then paint us all the same wide brush without taking consideration those organizations that have been doing things right. Luckily, they didn't move forward with underthought penalties during the lame duck session. And luckily, at least for the next 2 years, the governor has wanted to put the brakes on the wide brush and has made a statement that we have to look at municipalities and organizations individually, because there are those of us that are doing things right. And we are doing things right. Our employees are doing things right. Fantastic partners. God bless you all. And that's not just from me as an elected official, but a citizen of this city where my family's been for decades. And what we'll be doing is continuing to keep us strong so that I can get my kid's butt back here to make a life here in this home, this Muskegon, amongst all his neighbors, his friends, and his family. So thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Any other questions on this item? Commissioner Johnson?
No questions, but I just wanted to comment kind of in sync with you, Mr. Mayor, both with regard to the Service Employees International Union contract as well as the Police Officers Labor Council contract, that give appreciation and thanks to staff and the union members. It's been a lot of back and forth for many months now, and I am proud of our city funding position with regard to its pensions and legacy obligations. We are pretty healthily funded, and now we're strengthening that. And we are in part healthily funded because of the staff and past commissions. So my thanks to our veterans on this commission for seeing us through and ensuring our financial strength as a city. And I'm very much appreciative to our employees for helping us strengthen our fiscal position. It's going to save us hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. And this certainly helps put off that possibility of draining our general fund. Is this a perfect agreement? Probably not. You guys probably don't think it's 100% perfect. We probably don't think it's 100% perfect. I wouldn't mind tweaking it here to make it a little bit better for employees and tweaking it here to make it a little bit better for City Hall. We came together, and I think it is a good overall agreement. And so kudos to the employees, kudos to the union, kudos to staff on coming together and hammering this out. So thank you.
Very good. Anything else? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Turquest?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galvin?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Mensa-Biga?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Members of the SEIU and any members of the Police Officers Labor Council that are in attendance tonight, could you please stand? Thank you. Item I, please. No, item J. Whose was J's?
Oh, that's another one. That's me.
Okay, Commissioner German. Okay,
I move to approve the department comment changes for the rental department for 2017 master fee schedule.
Second.
It has been moved by Commissioner German, seconded by Commissioner Warren to approve the department comments changes for the rental department for 2017 master fee schedule.
Okay.
Good evening again. I'm going to stand in for finance if Derek will graciously allow me. He's done a lot of hard work on this fee schedule, but as this packet went out to you last Thursday, we continued to review this, and we actually noticed three corrections that need to be made before you actually approve this. And if you would, on this master fee schedule, it's this really complex looking thing. On 196, Ms. Jensen pointed out to me that in the description section, it should read rental property inspections, non-compliance fee, period. There's a little bit of word behind that. We're gonna change that. We're gonna remove that. And then in 197, it's gonna read in the description section, rental property inspections, non-compliance fee, starting with the second compliance reinspection. We're making those two changes to make this document correct. And down at 204, where it says environmental services, as we bring Safebelt in and they're doing different things now, they'll be in public safety working on the administrative of overhead, or of the demolitions. So that will be changed. Instead of saying environmental services, that'll be public safety. And if you go to the far right column for the fee for 2017, you'll see we're in 15, and then in 16, it went from 10%, 10%, 15%. This year, in 2017, instead of being 15%, that will go to 20. So those three corrections I'm bringing forth you today. The document, as we see it, looks good, except for those three proposed corrections we're bringing you.
Okay. Questions for Chief? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Warren?
I got one.
Sorry. Oh, sorry, Vice Mayor.
It's okay. Why did we decide to make the change on the 197 from the third to the second?
That was just one thing. I mean, I can have Safebelt come to explain it because they do that day-to-day thing. But as we talked through our negotiations and we tried to make this more incentive-driven, that was one of those. Kurt or either Deb, could you kind of explain or answer that question for him so I don't mess it up?
What number here, Chief?
197. It went from third to second. Yes. Okay. Deb. Maybe I have Deb. See, Deb's our number person. Come on up here, maybe.
Deb's our number person.
Everybody bring your bifocals.
I know, it is small. Well, the reason that number 197 goes from third to second is because on 196, it states that at the first, well, it doesn't say first, it does say it on the very right-hand side, you see department comments? That's correct, where it says after the first inspection. So with the comments on the left, where it said in parentheses second reinspection, that was incorrect. So the instructions or the comments on the right are correct. So we do one inspection now, okay, for the rental. And if they are not, they don't come in compliance, the next inspection, which is a re-inspection, there is a fee for that. So the only one inspection is now included in the registration every 4 years. If they don't pass, then the second one is a re-inspection. The fee starts there. And if there becomes a third and a fourth and a fifth by chance, there's an addition of $197. That's the additional amount of $15 each time we have to come out, the 40 plus 15.
So after the first inspection, they know what's wrong.
Correct.
And they have a certain amount of time to fix that.
Right. But when we send out the initial inspection letters telling mm-hmm. them, you know, we're coming out for the initial inspection, we also send along a four-page list of items that our inspectors will be checking. So they know what needs to be corrected. So rather than us going there the first time, giving them a list of what needs to be corrected, mm-hmm. they're going to have this list ahead of time so they can be proactive. And maybe look at this whole list and say, okay, got that. So there'll be less maybe corrections needed, okay, when we do that. And so they can get their certificate of compliance much faster.
Okay.
Okay?
Thank you.
All right.
Very good.
Commissioner Warren?
How far ahead of the inspection are those letters sent out?
I believe they're scheduled like 30 days out.
Okay. So they have about a month, give or take,
yeah.
to...
Okay. Give them 30-day notice. They have to have a lot of time to let the tenant know we're coming. Our inspectors are pretty much busy 30 days out.
Mm-hmm.
Mark, who is one of our inspectors, sitting next to them.
And then if they do need that second inspection, how much time is granted in between the first inspection and the second inspection?
Yep.
That depends on how many things are on their list.
Okay.
Some people have one. You know, they might get it done and want us to come back in a week.
Okay.
Some people might have 25, 30, 50. And depending on that list, we can work it out between, you know, 30, 45 days, okay. something like that. We don't want to get way out there because then they've got tenants in there with all these mm-hmm. violations.
Mm-hmm.
So we don't want to give them, you know, too much time.
Mm-hmm.
So it you know, varies a little bit. But between 30 and 45 would probably be the maximum.
Okay.
And they can reschedule up to a certain amount of times. So you can't keep rescheduling forever, but there's a certain amount of time that can reschedule in case this is a situation.
Okay, Commissioner German?
Now, what is your take on extensions? You know, how often do you give extensions for projects?
For building permits or for rental?
For rental, if they're not in compliance.
Dead ones, my name?
Well, so you're saying if we go in there the first time and they have a lot of things to get to take care of?
Right.
Okay, well, then we give them, like you said, 30 to 45 days. Mm-hmm. If they're not done at 30 to 45 days, then we would schedule another one out 30 days.
Mm-hmm.
Mark, maybe you can answer that, how many times we want to do that. I mean, if there's a tenant in there, you know, we don't want to continue a year out
mm-hmm.
while there's still all these violations.
A couple things that we look at is the severity of the violation. Smoke detectors, for example, we want to get those fixed within that 30-day period. If it's something like to patch in ceilings or walls or something, and there's a significant amount of that, window replacements due to weather and so forth, we're very flexible with that.
Okay.
So again, we look at it on an individual basis, you know, what are the severity of the violations versus, you know, other things that can go. One other part, for the winter months, exterior work on homes, we extend that to June 30th at this time. So a lot of times we have good weather in between. A lot of times there's 6-8 months to take care of exterior things. So we're flexible in that means too.
Well, that's good, because I was kind of looking more toward the weather conditions if they did have some type
Correct.
Of exterior problems.
We always try to keep the communication open so that they can call anytime prior to inspections so that we can communicate them, document their phone calls, document their complaints, and work with them in that fashion.
Okay, thank you.
Anything else? Roll call, please.
Mayor, let me add one thing.
Oh, yes, please.
I want the commissioner to know this. Is one thing we've done with this, there's an incentive built in here with the checklist, the punch list we're talking about, the information sheet that goes out. Any landlord that sees this, a rental property person, they'll see there's an incentive in here. If even though we raise the fees, if they pass it the first time in flying colors, so to speak, the next reinspection is kicked out quite a long time. So there's a reward or an incentive to pass that. They're not going to see us for a while. That's built in here. But the reinspections is not good because it's going to cost you more and more. So once the landlords figure this out, they're going to know, hey, do the punch list, read the information, get it done the first time. It's very rewarding if they do so, mm-hmm. even though we've raised the fees.
Okay. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsen-Mesivica?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galran?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Public hearings, please.
Public hearing, establishment of a commercial redevelopment district, 878 Jefferson Street, Suite 1, Planning and Economic Development. Summary of request. Pursuant to Public Act 255 of 1978 as amended, Gunter Properties LLC has requested the establishment of a commercial redevelopment district. The creation of the district will allow the building owner to apply for a commercial facilities exception certificate, which will freeze the taxable value of the building and exempt the new real property investment from local taxes. The district would only cover one suite in the building. Staff recommendation, establishment of the commercial redevelopment district.
Good evening, Mr. Franzik.
Good evening.
How the heck are you, Mike?
Pretty good. How are you? All right. So the developer or the owner of the building, he has a new client that's coming in, the embroidery shop, which you may have seen the signs in the window already. He owns that entire building, Carmen's, all the other suites in there. This pertains to just suite one, which is the embroidery shop. They are applying for the commercial facilities exemption certificate, which first you need to establish the commercial redevelopment district. So that's where we're at right now. The owner could not be here tonight. He was busy, but I believe Tammy Wynot from the embroidery shop over there is there for any questions you may have on her business.
Okay.
But just to clarify, the first step is creating the district, and the second step is to grant the certificate.
Very good. Any questions for staff at this point?
Question. I think I was reading the agenda on the line. This supposed to create, what, so many jobs? It was about five jobs?
Five jobs,
construction jobs, yeah. Okay.
Yep.
And it's good. It freezes taxes for how long?
I believe this one is for
9 years.
9 years.
It's a standard 6-year exemption, and they get 3 additional years for the amount they're investing. You may notice that we have another one right after this for a different project. They're investing a lot more money and getting a smaller years of abatement, but that is because the next one is for a new facility. So they're going to be getting a way bigger tax abatement because it's going to be on the entire new building, whereas this one is just freezing the taxes. So they will still be paying what they currently pay in taxes.
Thank you.
This is a question. Public hearing. Vice Mayor.
What determines what length of time for the tax abatement?
It's in our city policy for this. We have a policy for every type of abatement. Mm-hmm. So this commercial redevelopment policy for PA 255, it states the standard 6-year exemption, and then you get bonus years if you meet either the job creation or the amount of money you're putting into the building. And the amount, the job creation didn't really factor in to this one. We went with the amount that they're investing, which is $100,000. So they get those additional bonus years for meeting that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
This is a public hearing. Are there any members of the public that would like to address the establishment of this commercial redevelopment district at 878 Jefferson, Suite 1?
Yeah.
Commissioner.
Seeing none, I move that we close the public hearing and establish the commercial redevelopment district at 878 Jefferson Street, Suite 1.
Second.
It's been moved by Commissioner Rinsmer-Savinga, seconded by Commissioner German, to close the public hearing and establish a commercial redevelopment district at 878 Jefferson Street, Suite Number 1. Discussion? Comments? Roll call.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsmer-Savinga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gallman?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Motion passes.
And here's the part two of the process.
Public hearing. Issuance of a commercial facilities exemption certificate, 878 Jefferson Suite, our Street Suite 1, Planning and Economic Development. Summary request. Pursuant to Public Act 255 of 1978 as amended, Gunter's Property LLC has requested the issuance of a commercial facilities exemption certificate. The certificate will freeze the taxable value of the building and exempt the new real property investment from local and state taxes. The company will be investing $100,000 in creating 5 jobs, which qualifies them for an abatement of 9 years. Staff recommendation, issuance of the commercial facilities exemption certificate.
And we've mainly touched on this, unless there's additional comments or questions for Mike at this point on this. This is a public hearing. If there's any members of the public that would like to address the actual issuance of the commercial facilities exemption certificate.
Now, is she creating?
I need to have you come on up, Shirley, and give your name and address.
Shirley Green, 2574 Morton Avenue. Now, is she creating 5 more employees than what she has right now?
It would be 5 employees for this current location. So bringing over
what
from
she,
North Muskegon, yes.
Okay.
Not 5, unless you have anything to add to that.
Okay. I didn't catch all that.
They're currently located in North Muskegon, and they have about 5 employees. They're bringing those over here. They're not adding 5 more employees to what they already have.
But we're adding 5 more to the city.
We're adding 5 to the city. But she's going to remain having 5 employees from what she currently already has.
So there won't be any room for any new employees from the city of Muskegon?
No, that's... Whenever we give these abatements, we want to know how many new jobs we're creating in Muskegon. We're basically taking those jobs from going over from North Muskegon, and they're going to be here in Muskegon. Now, if they want to expand and hire more people, they certainly can, but they don't have plans for that right now.
Okay. Commissioner German?
Yeah. Young lady doesn't mind, I'd like to hear more from you and actually what is it that you're going to be doing your embroidering business on? T-shirts, sweatshirts, caps, or just could you enlighten us on that?
Good evening. If we could just get your name and address.
Tammy Wynott, and it's my home address?
Yeah.
488 Horton Road, North Muskegon.
Thank you.
So currently I have a location in North Muskegon. I have 2 suites in a strip mall. We're moving our production part of it downtown, as well as opening up a retail location, which will all be in one location. We will be keeping the North Muskegon location with 1 employee, just a small retail area. And it's possible we'll be hiring more employees as time goes on. But right now, there's no plans to add anybody else. We've been in business for 20 years. New screen printing, embroidery, do all of our decoration in-house.
Okay.
Okay. Vice Mayor?
Under your employment, do you have any minorities?
No.
In 20 years, have you?
Yes. And I'm considered a minority-owned business. I'm a veteran.
Okay.
So.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right, just a question also. And when we get these tax abatements, they do have to comply with the EOC regulations, or is it affirmative action with your department, Ms. Dewana?
That's just for our industrial facilities tax.
For industrial, not commercial?
We haven't historically done them for the other abatements, no.
Okay, okay. All right, thank you.
Vice Mayor?
I'm a veteran also, so sometimes I forget to say this that everyone says, but thank you for your service.
Oh, you're welcome.
And also, just one of the reasons we don't have that is typically the industrial businesses, they'll own their property or have a leasehold agreement. So they have control over who they're hiring, so we can have those policies. But this, the benefit goes to the building owner, and whoever he rents it out to, he doesn't necessarily have control over who that they may hire.
Okay.
Okay. Got that.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, and much luck, and thank you for, well, welcome home.
Thank you. Right. I've been wanting to be down here for a long time, so
very
I'm
good.
Excited.
I'll go eat breakfast and then come across the way.
There, exactly.
Mr. Mayor. One more there.
Yes.
Ms. Wynow.
Yes.
Very good for me. Understanding what Mr. Franzig just explained, that, you know, we can't necessarily put stipulations on you of, you know, try to hire, you know, X percent from the city, or, you know, have a workforce that is reflective of the awesome diversity of our city, because of you not being the property owner and you being a tenant, and
right.
This agreement
correct.
Is with the property owner, not you. However, could you assure us that if you are going to be hiring, expanding, and have new positions, that you will be looking to hire city residents and also expand the diversity of your workforce?
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. Appreciate it. You're thank welcome. You and welcome downtown.
Thank you.
Very good. You
I would
here.
Just like to say something as the Affirmative Action Director for the City of Muskegon. I'd like to congratulate us just for bringing a woman-owned business into the city.
Absolutely. I'll entertain a motion then. Commissioner Rinsma-Savinka.
I move we close the public hearing and issue the commercial facilities exemption certificate for 878 Jefferson Street, Suite 1.
Second.
It has been moved by Commissioner Rinsma-Savinka, seconded by Commissioner Warren, to issue the commercial facilities exemption certificate to 878 Jefferson Suite number 1. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Rinsma-Savinka?
Yes.
Commissioner Turquest?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galran?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
No.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Public hearing is item C.
Establishment of a commercial redevelopment district, 275 West Clay Avenue, planning and economic development. Summary request. Pursuant to Public Act 255 of 1978 as amended, Berkshire Muskegon LDHA LLC has requested the establishment of a commercial redevelopment district. The creation of the district will allow the building owner to apply for a commercial facilities exemption certificate, which will prove a 50% reduction in the number of mills levied as ad valorem taxes, excluding the state education tax. Staff recommendation, establishment of the commercial redevelopment district.
You're back on, Mike.
Yes. All right. So you may recall back in September of 2015, we approved a pilot for this development. They were not seeking any other type of tax abatements at that time. However, they were awarded their tax credits by MSHDA. But now it's kind of bad timing. There's a new presidential administration, and whenever that happens and it changes over, there's always some uncertainty of what's going to happen. So that affected the value of the tax credits, and their financial institution is not offering them as much money for them as they previously hoped. So they felt that that was going to kill the project, so they worked with staff so we could come up with some reasons or some possibilities to try to save the project. And we went through our toolbox, and we told them that this commercial redevelopment or the commercial exemption facilities certificate would be able to give them an abatement on the commercial aspect of the little over 4,000 square feet of commercial space they'll have on the first floor. And we also came up with the NEZ for the 16 market rate units that will now be put into the development.
Okay. Questions for staff? Mr. Johnson?
Not a question, just thank you. And thank you to the developers for working and, you know, coming up with creative solutions to keep that project going. I'm pleased that you know, if we approve this tonight, that the project can continue. And hopefully we'll get some shovels in the ground and a new multi-story building with commercial space. Very nice looking building too in design. So I'm excited about this, and I'm glad that we're able to keep the project alive. So thank you.
And an increase in market rate.
Yeah, I was going to talk about that at NEZ. Really excited about that. More market rate apartments.
Also, I'd like to introduce Josh Haffron from Berkshire
Project.
Yeah, I saw
Josh hiding behind
that. Here if you have any questions for him. I would also like to commend them on an agreement we made earlier as well. This pertains more to the certificate, but they wrote on their application 126 jobs created. But the application does ask for permanent jobs created and temporary, so that's kind of what they wrote in their application. After we reviewed it, we noticed that that's not really how we come up with the amount of years. We want to look at permanent jobs. So they went back to the drawing board and to see what they could pledge. They could have very easily just said they're going to create 21 jobs, which would give them the full 12 years. They didn't feel comfortable with that because they're not aware of exactly who they're going to bring in yet. So they are willing to go for the just 7-year abatement with the 6-year standard exemption, and then they get the one bonus year for having over $500,000 in investment.
Very good.
This is part of the senior citizen development that's coming in. There'll be commercial space there. Is that starting this year?
Yes. Yep.
Are there any members of the public that would like to address this issue of the establishment of the commercial redevelopment district at 275 West Clay? Commissioner Warren?
Seeing none, I move we close the public hearing and establish the commercial redevelopment district at 275 West Clay Avenue.
Support.
It's been moved by Commissioner Warren, supported by Commissioner Johnson, to establish a commercial redevelopment district at 275 West Clay. Any discussion, questions? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galran?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsmith-Sipiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item D under public hearing, please.
Issuance of a commercial facilities exemption certificate, 275 West Clay Avenue, Planning and Economic Development. Summary request. Pursuant to Public Act 255 of 1978 as amended, Berkshire Muskegon LDHAA LLC has requested the issuance of a commercial facilities exemption certificate. The certificate provides a 50% reduction in the number of mills levied as ad valorem taxes, excluding the state education tax for the commercial portion of the development. The company will be investing $587,000 in commercial space, which qualifies them for an abatement of 7 years. The total project costs include the residential portion are estimated at $16,296,000. $1,000, thank you.
Thank you.
Staff recommendation, issuance of the commercial facilities exemption certificate.
Anything additional, Mike?
No, unless you have any questions.
This is a public hearing. Are there any members of the public that wish to address the issuance of the commercial facilities exemption certificate for 275 West Clay? Vice Mayor.
Yes, I have a question for, is it Mr. Berkshire?
Haffron.
Heffron.
Yes.
Okay. And he's. Hi. Good, and you?
Good, thanks.
Hi, Josh.
Hello.
So you are the.
I'm the partner with the development group.
Partner with the development group? Okay, and you possibly bring in 20 jobs to the city?
No, so. We're going to have 4,300 square feet of commercial space to lease. We're gonna guarantee for the abatement that we'll produce 5 or 6 jobs, because we're just not sure what's gonna come of the space. We're talking to several groups now who might come in, might not come in, but we'll as part of the project itself, we'll have 2 full-time employees as a property manager and a maintenance engineer, and then we assume we'll get at least three or four others in the commercial space.
Okay, and will these be residents from the city, or are you bringing them in?
The property, we don't know who, we haven't identified the property manager or the maintenance engineer yet. Mm-hmm. Building probably, if we start this spring, the building won't be done till next spring. So we probably won't engage the search until late fall of this year, if we, you know, once we get started. But we do, as a rule, like to hire locals. So we're building one now in Paw Paw, Michigan, and the property manager there is a local as well as the maintenance guy.
And you are equal opportunity employee.
Yeah, we are. Well, we technically, I don't want to get too complicated, but technically we're not the employer. We have a third-party property manager, KMG, who is, as far as I know, equal opportunity employer. They're managed 19,000 units. Okay. I don't know how they couldn't be.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Any other questions for Mr. Haffron? Okay. So we are closed on public hearing, right? And we're ready for the vote. Did I do that?
No, we haven't closed yet.
Yeah. Okay.
I move to close the public hearing and issue a commercial facilities exemption certificate for 275 West Clay Avenue.
Second.
It's been moved by Commissioner Johnson, seconded by Commissioner German, to issue a commercial facilities exemption certificate for 275 West Clay Avenue. Any further comments or questions? Roll call, please.
Mayor Galvin?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsmith-Sibiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Item E under public hearings.
Public hearing, request to create a new neighborhood enterprise zone district at 275 West Clay Avenue, Planning and Economic Development. Summary of request. Pursuant to Public Act 147 of the Michigan Public Acts of 1992, Berkshire Muskegon LDHA, LLC has requested to create a new neighborhood enterprise zone district for the parcel at 275 West Clay Avenue for a mixed-use development. Staff recommendation to hold the public hearing.
All right. So when we were looking at ways to help save the development, it was on December 13th that they sent in a written request to establish the neighborhood enterprise zone district. So we sent out mailers on the 13th of December to the local taxing jurisdictions. So we have to wait 60 days after that to approve the district, and in between that time we have to hold the public hearing. So this is just simply the public hearing, and we will be back on February 14th to create the actual certificate or the district.
Okay. So we're just holding the public hearing?
Yes.
No action?
Correct.
Okay. Except to close it.
To close the public hearing eventually, yes.
Very good. Any questions for staff? Mr. Johnson?
Given that we've got the payment in lieu of taxes already set up for the project, this NEC is only for the market rate apartments?
Correct. It'll only affect the 16 market rate apartments.
Excellent. I'm really excited that you now are including market rate apartments and that, if I recall correctly, I was urging that last year we approved this.
Yeah, we're really excited.
Happy about that.
This is a public hearing. Are there any individuals that would like to speak to the request for the new neighborhood enterprise zone district at 275 West Clay? Doesn't look like it. Can I get a motion? Commissioner Warren?
I move we close the public hearing.
Support.
It's been moved by Commissioner Warren and supported by Commissioner Rinsmith-Sibiga to close the public hearing. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rinsmith-Sibiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Galvin?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. New business, please. Well, thank you, Mike. Thank you, Josh. Thank you, Kathy. Anybody else involved here? Derek, numbers guy. Were you involved at all? Okay. I'm not going to thank you then. New business.
Community Relations Committee recommendations for various city boards and committees. City Clerk. The request is to make recommendations for appointments to the various boards and committees of the Community Relations Committee as presented as listed below. Planning Commission, Jill Montgomery Keast, Brian Mazade, Marsha Hobby Wright. Civil Service, Johnny Brown. Downtown Development Authority, Mike Johnson, Don Callis. Zoning Board of Appeals, Ernest Fordham, Jonathan Whitmer, Tammy Halterman. Housing Code Board of Appeals, William Crick, Boyd Arthur. Historic District Commission, Susan Crows, Stephen Racky. Staff recommendation approval.
Thank you. Can I get a motion? Commissioner Warren?
I move we approve the recommendations of the Community Relations Committee from their January 24, 2017 meeting.
Support. It's been moved by Commissioner Warren, seconded by Commissioner Johnson to approve the recommendations of the Community Relations Committee from our January 24th, 2017 meeting. Any questions, comments before we take the vote? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Warren?
Yes.
Commissioner German?
Yes.
Commissioner Rensselaer-Sabiga?
Yes.
Commissioner Turnquist?
Yes.
Commissioner Johnson?
Yes.
Mayor Gowron?
Yes.
Vice Mayor Hood?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Thank you. Any new business, commissioners?
I was going to ask the city manager a question, but he just left.
He knew what was coming.
I'm just wondering if we have any updates on some things that have been approved. The L.C. Walker construction, where a tenant was coming in there, the distillery on Henry Street, and the 18th Amendment.
I don't know anything.
Well.
I know he left.
I say I did see Whistlepunk put in their oven at 18th Street Amendment, or 18th Amendment, not 18th Street.
Yeah, they
18th Amendment, so it looks like things are coming along.
Seems that's probably the longest running one that we're waiting for, but
right.
Have there been problems with the business coming in, the L.C. Walker and the distillery on Henry Street? I haven't seen anything going on there.
No, I don't know anything about that. And as far as I don't know anything more here than our last memos on the Frank, question on from Commissioner Turnquist regarding any progress on the commercial distillery at L.C. Walker. Any word on the proposed distillery on Sherman? And any known information on the 18th Amendment?
Well, I would say this. We're still not quite there on the L.C. Walker side. We had some initial bids that came in pretty high that were a little scary, that we've essentially asked the contractor to go back and reevaluate, and it's taken some time to break those down and reevaluate it. So I'm comfortable that at some point we're going to come to you guys with a plan to move forward. Whether or not it's at the full scope is what we thought it was in terms of the full distillery and things like that. We're not quite sure if we're going to get the cost down to that point yet, but I'll have a report to you guys as soon as we have that information. I have not followed up nor heard anything about the Sherman Road since they've been in here. I don't know if anybody, I don't see any staff out there to even give an update on that one. And 18th Amendment keeps saying they'll be open as soon as they can, not a day sooner. I drove by this morning, all the lights were on, and it looks pretty darn good in there. Whistlepunk is just, if you notice, if you follow Whistlepunk Pizza on Facebook, they officially changed their address to that address like yesterday. So it sounds like they're getting pretty darn close. But they don't want to, I think they're trying to manage expectations. So to quote Michael Brower, they'll be open as soon as they can, not a day sooner. But they're working on it.
Thank you.
Commissioner Warren.
I wanted to bring up, residents have brought up to me before, and it's something we've discussed, the idea of streaming our meetings live using something like Facebook Live or something like that. And so I just wanted to bring it up again, that is a request that's out there, and that hopefully we can look into that to make these more accessible to our residents.
Commissioner Warren.
I have been the commissioner that has been working with Revel and working with city staff when it comes to the city logo. And as I think most of us know, the most recent round of designs that were released have not been exceptionally popular. And when I was looking at the city website last I looked, where people could actually vote for our current logo, I think that was, if not winning, pretty close. when it comes to which was most favorable out of the four, the three new logos and then our current logo. So I just wanted to take this opportunity with everybody here to kind of gauge some input of what you've been hearing, and so that we can intentionally move forward, because this has been a hot topic. I've been reached out to by a lot of designers, residents, business owners that are concerned with the current options. And so just wanted to hear from others if you've heard anything or how we may proceed forward.
Vice Mayor?
I haven't heard anything, but just my personal opinion, I wasn't feeling the new ones either. Mm-hmm.
Commissioner Turnquist?
I've heard from down in Ward 4, there's not too much enthusiasm about any of them.
Mm-hmm. Mr. German?
Had some negative feedback. Mm-hmm. And I can kind of see where some of the residents feel like that, because we talk about, you know, budget constraint, and we're looking to spend dollars into a logo that really won't make a difference, if you ask me. If you're looking at image, personally, I don't see a need for it. That's just my take. I think it's just, you know, physical irresponsibility of spending money that we say we don't have. Mm-hmm. So, and I've had that feedback also from some constituents as well.
I think we budgeted so much money that we're spending already, right, to get some pre-design work done. And then the whole implementation of the logo is another consideration. And I've heard it said that we might just redo things as we need to. So, you know, I'm not sure how the budgetary implications aren't exactly clear to me, except for I think we agreed to spend $7,500, which we're doing anyway, which we're doing now. So if we do nothing, we'll spend the $7,500 and we'll be where we are. So we'll have spent $7,500 and done nothing. I mean, I don't know. Logos are a tough thing and identity is a tough thing, but and I know people can be nostalgic and they can like the things to be the same, but I guess that shouldn't always stop us. And the current logo is very unwieldy and really kind of unusable in a modern era of how logos are printed and used. So I'm not I don't know that people don't like the, they didn't like, or you know, the first three that we talked about last summer, people didn't really like, and it seems like people don't like these. But at some point, I think it's a positive to get a new logo that's somewhat updated and looks modern. So I just caution to say that we're going to spend the $7,500. The implementation of it, we could decide how much we actually want to invest in that or not. But my personal opinion is moving forward would be a good idea, that it would be nice if we actually had something with where we're at, because we're never going to get complete agreement, and we could always be stuck with the old one because that's easy, but I'm not sure that that's where we want to be. It might hurt at some point, but I think 10 years down the line we'll be glad we have something a little bit more relevant.
Commissioner Jessen?
I've heard quite a bit from the various neighborhood associations, as well as from my commission page on Facebook. Got a lot of feedback. By and large, the three logos were not well received. People really hated C, for the most part. Some people liked it, thought it was aggressive, but people really hated that shield. Didn't know if it looks like a tie or a sword or what. The B with the circle, some people liked it. They thought that if you had to explain it, then it was kind of lost, and they weren't gung-ho about it, but they didn't hate it as much as C. A was probably the one that if they had to choose, they would choose A, which was looked like some call a patch or a badge. You know, it's got our Together Rising sculpture downtown. But people, by and large, did not think they were the greatest. They wanted to know why we're doing this. They wanted to know, what is the purpose of it? We've got Watch Us Go, and that's been successful, so let's continue with that. Let's stick with that. Let's grow that. Why are we, spending staff resources and time on coming up with a new logo? And I kind of wondered that myself as well. We launched as three logos in 2015 and did public forums at Jackson Hill and at McGrath Park, got input about those three logos, and then we surveyed city staff, and city staff pretty much excoriated those three logos. They didn't like them, by and large. And I remember myself and Commissioner Turnquist also asking at that time, given that we were had a road millage on the ballot, and we also had a special assessment going for streetlights, why are we spending time and resource on this when we're asking for more money from citizens? And so it got suspended, and then it was revived sometime last year, but not so much with conferring with the commissioner consultation. I understand you, a commissioner, and appreciate the work you've done on that. But it is a relatively small committee, too. As I understand it, it's made up of three staff members, one commissioner, and one person from Revel, two from Revel. Majority of those people, or about half, aren't even city residents, and it's not diverse. It's entirely middle class or upper, and all Caucasian. That committee itself doesn't reflect the diversity of our community. And so if we are adamant, and I think this is what we need to hear from city staff, from the city manager, and from the logo committee, that if we're adamant about doing this, then we need an explanation as to why. What's it for? What's its purpose? Rather than just something feel good or we want something prettier on there, what's its intent? What's the full cost going to be? Not just the $7,500 to design it, but what's going to be the cost to implement it? And include more of the public, because if we're going to do this, we should do this in a more methodical manner, so that it does feel representative of our community and citizens can feel connected to it. When this logo was adopted, a few decades ago, it was more of a community affair. And when we did our forum, back in McGrath in 2015, we had people that were part of that logo search process, and they had such pride when they spoke about it. That's what I would like to recapture. If we're going to do this, if we've got a strong reason to do this, and we want to do it, and we're all in it, let's do it in a methodical manner, and revive that pride in the process, in the ultimate outcome as well. Also one other thing I heard from a lot of people: why don't you allow public submissions? Basically, why are you not asking for people to give public submissions? Another thing is people do like our current logo. They're not necessarily love it. They understand it is a little outdated. They understand that the color scheme might be a little stale. So they're willing to, there's a willingness. It's not like a 100% of rejection. There's some, but there's a willingness. And they would like to see, from what I've heard, and I personally also, happens that we were the same, but included in the mix, a updated logo of what we have already, or something inspired by it. That it's continuation of what that process was a few decades ago with the community input. So I think if we need to decide we're not going to do it, and we're going to ride out Watch Us Go for now from a marketing and an image perspective, and revisit this down the road, maybe under more prosperous times, and when we have greater staff bandwidth, or if we do it in a much more methodical approach that is welcoming of public input, and finding something that people can feel pride in. Okay. So thank you, seriously, thank you, Commissioner Warren, and staff, for your time on this. And putting out that survey to get input from the public. It's really important that we have that public input.
Yeah, if I could really quickly. First of all, Watch Muskegon, I don't think it was ever intended to be our logo. I guess there's an opportunity that we could think about it. Remember when we agreed to do this, it was about the same time Watch Muskegon came out. It was like, rolling with the punches, essentially. You know, watch Muskegon got on, everybody loved it, and they said, okay, now let's continue with updating our image, or the, you know, this is what we're mailing out when we mail out letters, not watch Muskegon necessarily on the top. And that's an option. We never really considered it as an option, but it's an option. I think if you were to ask staff now, me, I guess, who's been dealing with this, I would say that, you know, it's kind of been, from the public standpoint, it's kind of been a thankless but busy undertaking. You know, we worked hard on the first five. We knocked two of those out, presented three of them, and took input and essentially got beat up on those. Brought back three completely different ones and got beat up on those, and pretty much were told to go back to this one. I don't know how much of us. I would love to continue to keep working on it, but I don't. If the people want this one, then you know, I'll gladly work on one of 700 other things probably I could work on. But we were trying to focus on something that moved the community forward, kind of like Dan said, up, brush off our image, push forward on it. Same thing with Revel. Sometimes at some point we feel like maybe they're even getting a little bit discouraged. You know, through the process, they, you know, they work hard and they bring things forward. People don't like them. That's fine. But I would say if probably with them, we probably should either decide if we want to keep moving with them or cut loose and then do kind of essentially what Commissioner Johnson said, or do we just want to keep what we have or refresh what we have? When we started the process, it was, let's work with Revel and let's develop these, you know, this idea of a logo. We took input, I think, from this group, from people at the meetings, and we had a big list of things that everybody felt represented Muskegon. Here's what I think has been the problem is that Muskegon is not a typical lakefront community. A lot of lakefront communities aren't as deep. They don't have as much depth as Muskegon does. So you can plop a lighthouse on a circle and say, bam, there's our community, because that represents everybody. The problem with Muskegon is, and it's not a problem, the issue with Muskegon is a lighthouse doesn't represent the city. You know, there's this beach town component of it, but there's this whole diverse urban component of it, and there's this cultural component. And the more things we try to fit on the logo, the more people notice that their favorite component is left off the logo. And so at some point, we're going to have to decide, do we want the logo to represent everything our community is, or just give you a snapshot of what our community could be? Or what I was initially envisioning it would be just a more, I guess, a brighter, I don't want to say contemporary, but a brighter look for the things that we're mailing out that just speaks right. A little more to the future, but doesn't necessarily say everything that Muskegon is. Like, watch Muskegon doesn't say everything that Muskegon is, but the goal was that it gets you talking about all the things that Muskegon is. I think we'll have trouble designing a logo that makes probably more than a plurality happy. Yeah. Happy, you know, and so, but we're, I think from a staff standpoint anyway, I rambled on. We're interested in doing whatever the community wants us to do and whatever this board wants us to do. I don't know, like I said, I don't know how much of a stomach there is to go back to Revel and say, okay, come up with three more designs and take this input. Because I think they did work pretty hard on it. And I think they, you know, they took three very different ones and came up with you know, they took our input and tried to develop something. But if we want community, for example, if we were to take community submissions, I don't know how we're getting, you know, yeah, community input. We're getting each individual person's individual view of what a logo should be. We talked at a staff level this idea of maybe we put a citizen committee together. Mm-hmm. People can submit to us. We can work with Revel. We can do a combination of those, but essentially leave it up to the citizen committee, knowing that, or at least to make a recommendation to this group, knowing that citizen committee could very well put three logos out there that everybody bashes, you know, or everybody loves or whatever. But at some point we want to entrust a group of people to help make a, you know, to make a decision and stand by it. Because there, like I said, there were, you know, if you look at the voting, there were people that picked some of these, and there were people that picked the current one, and there were people that picked none of the above. Mm-hmm. They were seriously, it was spread out pretty equally, except there are a lot less people picked the shield, but I mean, you could almost look at every one of those. Man, hundreds of people voted for that one. So, anyway, I don't know if I answered your question.
No, that's you know, what I haven't heard any negatives. It's not that people particularly like the design or whatnot, but what I've heard is that people appreciated the process. They thought it was, you know, it's neat. You know, we're continuing to look at, you know, new visions, new marketing, new, but we ain't gonna solve this tonight. Okay? So we can revisit this, but I'm wondering if staff, along with a couple additional commissioners, I know that Commissioner Warren, you've been seated with this, is that, you know, maybe from what you're hearing tonight, and we'll hear additionally, another commissioner with some staff maybe flesh out what would be a next best step, because we are hearing quite a bit about, you know, the citizen input. You know, Frank pushed forward even with, you know, a citizens group or committee. But what would that look like, and how would that be channeled? So let's get our heads around that and see how we move forward in the next months. But I think it's a good exercise. I really do. It gets us thinking and it gets us talking. And you know, how do we present ourselves? And it can be exciting. So, Vice Mayor.
I know I said we had input about the, like the old logo, and I think maybe they just was doing too much for coming up with a logo. I mean, the old logo is nice, but it needs color. Have they ever thought of just adding some color to the old logo? I don't know if that was kicked around or not, or if it's just a totally different design, but some of them just seem like they just did too much, got a little too proactive.
And I think those are the type of thoughts that we, you know, can visit as we, you know, decide to move forward. But I think the real key here is what I'm hearing is that, you know, how do we engage the, you know, community more? Some people want to input, and some people just don't care, and some people think, you know, fine, you know, go ahead. But I'm thinking, you know, ultimately, I think we can come up with something, you know, very, very beautiful and representative and fresh and new. Maybe. But Commissioner Turnquist.
Well, I agree with what Dan said earlier. We need to have a newer, more up-to-date logo, and what Ken has said. The Watch Us Go has been a very enthusiastic thing. We're waiting to see. We're not the same city as we were in the 40s, where, you know, the Hackley Tower, and hopefully that'll never get torn down, but if we leave the Hackley Tower, that may disappear. But I think we have a sculpture down at the center of town, at the front hall, Muskegon.
Together Rising.
Yeah, which represents the new, and I'd like to see that incorporated with some of the old and the transition. And where we're going.
And I'd just say, if we're going to do it, we're either going to commit to a process and do a new logo, or we're going to not talk about this again for 5 years. Mm-hmm. Because this back and forth, I mean, like I said, I've been on a bunch of logo committees, and they're always painful. You either just got to live with the compromise, mm-hmm. or just don't even go there. So right. I say, if we're going to lay out a process, it's got to be like, we're going to get a new logo, that's for sure, and this is the process, and when we get there, whoever is in the plurality, that's what we're doing. Mm-hmm. Because otherwise you'll just talk around this for, it you is. Know, another
and, and
year
it's kind of like that okay. thing I had done in December called a root canal. but we'll do well. Commissioner Johnson.
I completely agree. We either have to suspend it for an indefinite time, or come up with process, move forward, and then agree with the outcome. whatever that may be. The aim or the intent is to have flashier, prettier, more energized stationery, then that we send out notifications and send out letters to people, then I mean, what's wrong with just incorporating Wash Muskegon in that? It doesn't have to be our city logo on these materials. I mean, if that is the crux of the aim, then maybe we should just adopt, you know, Wash Muskegon for our stationery or for those communications, if that's what the aim is. But I would just say, if one process for us to consider, and you know, maybe we can discuss this at our work session next month, but one process forward that I would say is maybe we pick the best one that was presented the last three, the winning in the polls, to be kept and included going forward, get an update of their current one, and then allow public submissions, and then have that citizen committee vet those public submissions and winnow it down, and then we'll have a final three that will be decided and done.
Too much detail.
So,
that's exactly what I think, you know, we can work on. But let's digest this tonight, and then I'll, with y'all, we'll be revisiting this, and we'll start with the smaller internal group, a couple of commissioners, staff, to build on the work that is, you know, completed, where we're at as a foundation, and see how we will, you know, proceed. Digest it tonight, and we will be talking further. Okay. Anything else under new busyness? It's now time to open for public comment. Citizens are invited to come to the podium. Each citizen is given 3 minutes to make comment or share a concern with the commission. Typically, people do come with concerns. We can't always give you the answer tonight. I know that a couple of these individuals that are asking to speak do have issues specifically regarding safe build. I do want you to come, give your comments, but then I will be referring you to the liaison or the, Kurt, should I send them, refer them to Chief?
Yes.
Okay. I'll be referring you to Chief Lewis, who provides oversight for the city with safe build, to discuss your issues with you and to hopefully formulate a resolution and also provide us with a report. And to begin, I have a Ms. Denise Sweet.
I'm going to be representing
her. Okay. Are you Anthony?
Yes.
Anthony Hild?
Hild.
Okay, Mr. Hild, if you just want to come on up. I just need your name and address. You have 3 minutes. Please express your concern, and then hang tight because I'm going to give you the contact for Chief Lewis, okay?
All right. I'm Anthony Hild. The current address that I'm staying at is 1871 Care Drive, Apartment C, but I am representing a friend of mine, and her address is 1785 Dyson.
Is that 1875?
1785.
Okay, go right ahead, Mr. Hill.
And the concern was on December 17th of 2016, Safeboat came by and issued a stop work permit. And the fact of the matter is that there had been no work done at all to the house. And when we called about the complaint, Kurt told us that he admitted to coming up onto the property and looking through the front porch window and taking pictures. And I told my friend Denise and the other person that was there that that's violation of the Fourth Amendment, which is stating that I have a right to privacy within my own home. And when we contacted him about the complaint, he told us basically to get a lawyer and that there was nothing we could do about it. There was no way to resolve the issue at all. He just told us to basically get a lawyer and that he did nothing wrong. Well, basically you did do something wrong when you admitted to coming onto the property. You approached the front porch and came up onto the property and then began taking pictures of the existing conditions of the house on the inside. And then issued the stop work order when no work had been done. That's basically what it's. And now she's in fear that anybody can just come up to the house and take pictures or do whatever.
Okay.
To the house.
I'll have, I do have Ms. Sweet's contact information. I'll direct staff okay. to contact Ms. Sweet.
Okay.
And work through the situation.
All right, thank
okay?
you.
Thank you, Mr. Hill. Mr. Yohannik, you also have please come on up and give your name and address, and yes, I'll be making a referral for you to Chief Lewis.
My name is Robert Yohannik. My address is 3950 Thona Street, Muskegon, Michigan, 49444. Actually, I put in two forms, and one of them kind of is with a few questions that Kirk can actually answer, hopefully. I'm a landlord in town, and I work really close with Safebuilt because it's necessary to make sure you have safety in your apartments. I get along really good with the rental inspectors when they come up, and if they tell me something's wrong, I do what I can to fix it. First question is, according to the contract, Safebuilt's recommending going to the International Building Code, correct?
We're using the International Building Code
now.
Okay.
The
Michigan version of the International Building Code.
Okay, and that's
the International Building Code?
That might be. Is that what we're switching to? The what you just said, the maintenance code. Yes.
Something we're looking at.
Okay. The reason I'm asking is this information isn't so easy to find. For somebody like me, I grew up in the construction field. My dad's a contractor. We built multiple houses growing up. Plus, I suffered from insomnia, so reading code book really kind of solves that problem. But what I suggest is maybe making that, and I know Kirk and I have spoke about problems with not being able to find code online, and it's almost like playing a game with somebody and not telling them the rules till after you're already playing. So I'm suggesting we put, you know, the code that we're suggesting or is being suggested online, so at least people know or have the opportunity to take a look at it and move forward with it, you know? So that was my first thing. My second thing is, and I attempted to go the proper route with this. I spoke with Commissioner German a few times about this as well. Last May, I have a property at 398 Monroe, and as I was gone in the middle of the day, Mr. Briggs walked in, and started taking pictures. Now, and this caused a huge problem, and I had spoke with Mr. Briggs a number of times about it because I had to cool off because I felt like my rights were violated. And we worked it out somewhat. Wasn't happy with the results, so I left a message with the chief of police. You were at the range, I think, that day. Hadn't heard anything back, and that's when I started moving up the chain. I got as far as speaking with the state of Michigan. Charlie Curtis, who is Building Code Division Assistant Chief, so he basically is over top of all this, second in charge. 104.3 states right of entry. Right of entry is the inspector has to make reasonable attempt to contact the owner in order to gain access to the properties. I've always answered my phone for safe belt, and if I can't answer, I always return the phone call. I've never been hard to find. And he had just gotten out of a meeting with the Attorney General. They were doing training on this very subject. He put it on speakerphone. The Attorney General said that the only way he could go into the property without consent of the owner's agent, which it's a registered vacant building, and it clearly states I'm the agent, or the resident, once again, vacant building, is the only other way is through a court order. And taking pictures just goes that much further. We weren't doing anything illegal. We had a permit pulled on the roof, and we were working diligently on that roof, which led to a whole different mess that has nothing to do with safe build. The problem at this point is it kept going up the chain, and I never got response. It seemed like nothing was done. It felt like it was pushed under, swept under the rug. It's water under the bridge as far as the pictures go. I mean, he was going to get in anyways, because if he would have asked, I would have let him in anyways. Okay? But when something like this happens, it's not going to just go away. It's something that has to get addressed. And there's a lot of people in this town. I spend a lot of time downtown. They're afraid of safe built. Safe built serves a purpose. And for the most part, they do their job. But when something like this happens, a lot of people, like Miss Sweet is a perfect example, she's afraid of her own home. We've got to address this stuff. And we've got to revisit this. We've got to take a look at the issues.
Yeah, it's it may be water under the bridge, but not necessarily. So I still would like you to get with Chief Lewis.
Absolutely.
In order to see if there was a missing stitch.
Yes.
Someplace. And as you heard about a number of improvements as far as context, et cetera.
Yes.
And process. Let's see how we don't need to revisit, these issues again, if at all humanly possible.
Yep.
And, you'll see Chief Lewis, and let's go back through, see what occurred.
Absolutely.
And so that, people aren't feel like they're left holding the bag.
For okay.
Whatever reason.
Excellent.
It's good to see you again.
You too.
Okay.
How's Arby's?
I'd like to say something also. Robert, I'd like to thank you for participating and coming down in our public hearing and the participation. As a commissioner, your commissioner in your ward, I have an open door policy, and that's all my constituents and anyone in the city of Muskegon, if you choose to call, I'm more than welcome to serve. And that's what I do as elected official. Made every effort, but sometimes, due to the congested schedules, here at the city, things that goes on, sometimes the docs doesn't get connected. But it's not intentionally, but, we try to solve and try to work with, like we talked earlier, with Safe Build to make sure we have a cohesive relationship with our citizens and residents, also with the organization. So thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Are there any other members of the public that would like to address the commission at this point? Shirley, what you want?
Yeah, I want a lot.
You like my tie?
Yeah, love it. Shirley Green, 2574 Morton Avenue. I just have a question for Ann. During the summer concerts with the food trucks, our neighborhood and Glenside puts on events there when we sponsor. I'm with the Lakeside Business District as well. And when we sponsor a concert there, we bring in goodies and water and pop, whatever, and it's all by donation. And that's how we make some of our money. And if you allow a food truck to come in, that defeats our purpose.
Are you talking in McGrath Park?
McGrath Park concerts.
Right, and that actually goes under a whole where they have to be approved through the Department of Public Works within a contract that comes to the city commissioners to approve. So that doesn't have any bearing on the food trucks that we just did tonight. They're not allowed to go into the parks without that contract.
So they would have to get permission first to...
From the city commission, yes, that's correct.
Okay.
And that didn't happen tonight, no.
Okay.
You're good.
Thank you.
Yep.
All right. Are there any other individuals that would like to address the commission? Well then, Vice Mayor.
I move to adjourn.
Support.
It's been moved by the Vice Mayor, supported by Effervescent. Commissioner Johnson, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
I didn't get that many myself.
I struggled.